Hello, my name is Kyle Adamson. I am the pastor here at Songs of Hope Church, and I am so glad you have joined us here today for our online service. I want to let you know a couple of things, that if you have prayer requests or concerns or comments, please put those in the notes section below. We would love to communicate with you and be praying for you throughout this week. If you would like to give an offering back for all the great things that God has blessed you in your life, there is a link to our online giving below as well. I want to let you know that we meet here every Thursday night at 6:30 p.m. at Songs of Hope Church at 102 South 9th Street in Beech Grove. We would love for you to be our guest here, and we're happy that you've joined us online. We hope you enjoy our service today. May God bless you.
Like I said, we're going to talk about several different events during Holy Week that we celebrate this week. Last Sunday was Palm Sunday that we celebrated Jesus being welcomed into Jerusalem. He was the hero. He was the man. Everyone loved him then. But how quickly did that fade? So I want to do a comparison that I hope you get, because I don't know if my wife knew where I was going with this. So these are characters of what movie?
Frozen.
So I got to start off by saying, are you a Frozen 1 person or a Frozen 2 person? One, raise your hand. Oh, come on. Two, raise your hand. Thank you, Gabby. I'm sorry, you don't understand that one, the original, like so many movies, was the best. One was the iconic songs. Sorry, I love them. I think I got my granddaughter all worked up because I have her Frozen toys. Although, so actually I'll hold this over here because I gotta, so here's why I bring this up. Why are you bringing up Frozen and Jesus? There is a place where I'm going with this. Think about it. This movie starts off, I'm driving her nuts right now. This movie starts off by these beloved characters, right? Everyone loved Anna and Elsa. They were the heroes. And then there was trouble. Something was happening that not everybody understood. They didn't know where this was going. Then there was a period that everybody was against Elsa. She went from the hero, everyone loved her, to they wanted her out of the kingdom. They didn't want her around anymore. Then what was going to happen? Well, then the bad guys come in. But one in particular, I didn't have a doll for him. Anyone remember his name? I forgot to look it up. Hans, thank you. How to forget Hans. So Hans comes in, and he comes in with these terrible intentions, these selfish ambitions. He didn't even care what would happen, even if he had to kill off the heroes. He didn't care. But we know what happened, right? Justice prevailed. Ultimate love prevailed until it was happily ever ending. So what's this have to do with Easter and Jesus? Think about it. I know, you don't know. Well, I'm going with it. I'm coming here. Today we're combining, as I said, Maundy Thursday, the Last Supper, Good Friday, the death of Jesus, and then Easter, the resurrection. Much like a movie trailer, so many movie trailers are like this, right? You go from the hero is everyone loves them, and all of a sudden there's a villain, and everyone's against them, but in the end, the good movies, at least in my opinion, have a happy ending. That's kind of how the story of Jesus goes. If she wants these, she can come get them. Although, I don't know, I was struggling to find a place for Olaf. Olaf needs a character in scriptures to relate to, because he's the best. I don't know who it is, but so anyhow. So here we go. So here's the short story of Jesus that we're going to put into this in this frame. But I also want to bring up this. I've talked about this so many times. We are in a time in our country's history where more and more people seem to be walking away from the Christian faith. So we're in Holy Week that so many of us who are here that are Christians are watching online, where it's like, this is the celebration, right? How many of us on Sunday are going to say, He is risen on our family photos? He is risen indeed, absolutely. But there are so many people, when you ask, when they do all the polls, and this is something that's been going on for actually a couple of decades now, it's just getting worse year after year, and that's people who are not believing the stories anymore. In fact, the largest religion, if you ask the pollsters, are those that we call nuns. When they write what religion, it's none of the above. That section of people, especially young people, are growing more and more each year, and it's not that they don't know the stories, it's not that they haven't heard of Jesus, it's the fact that they just don't believe them. So I'll put it this way, if you're watching online, or if you're here, and maybe that's your story, and you were here because somebody asked you to come for one of the two Sundays, or I guess two holidays that most people come to church, Easter and Christmas, I want to say thank you. Thank you for watching, thank you for being here. It's okay that you don't believe. My goal with this story is to share what Jesus' death and resurrection meant in our lives. And so that we can and I want this to be a church. My goal when we started this church was to have a place that you could understand the scriptures, the Bible, and understand, you know, why we believe what we do. You may not understand it all, but to be able to explain it in a way that you can understand it for yourselves and find out why it is important to you. And then you'll just have to make a choice, as many of us have, whether you want to follow Jesus as we have. So we're going to start off scripture. We're going to look at, so before I go into them, I'm going to go through all books of the Gospels, all four books, which is Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the start of our New Testament, the new covenant that Christ made for all of the Jews and the Gentiles. Gentiles are those of us who are non-Jewish, which I believe is all of us in here today. And I love looking at the four different books for this reason. This is why we can believe the validity of the scriptures, because these were four different people that had four different perspectives. Two of them, Matthew and John, were actual disciples of Jesus. Then we had Mark in here, who was younger at the time, and actually more than likely the theologian said that he was around Jesus' teaching and maybe witnessed some miracles, but he really was a disciple of Peter later on, who was an eyewitness, a disciple of Jesus. And then we have Luke, the physician, very smart, Greek-oriented man himself, who investigated so many people of the disciples that he knew that he got their stories from. So we're going to look at different versions of their story. We're going to start off in Matthew. We're going to start off in John, which is the last of the Gospels, which his Gospel I love because it's less than the other three stories of the Gospels of Jesus. This is much more the miracles, the love, the works of who Christ was. And what we're going to start off with the Last Supper. So I made myself a mini version of the Last Supper up here. We're going to start off in chapter 13, verse 1. And it says, "It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress." So imagine all the disciples up here having their meal. Come on up and have your meal here, one of the random disciples. So they were all eating. And while it was in progress, the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. So most of us have heard the story that Judas was going to betray Jesus, one of his close disciples. "Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and then he was returning to God. So he got up from the meal. He took off his outer clothing, wrapped the towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin." And as he was doing this, very small basin, he started to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. This was something, as I've said many times before, that rabbis didn't do, teachers didn't do. This is something Jesus came to show, that he was different. He had a different kind of kingdom that he wanted to show them. Then going on in verse 12, "When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. And he asked, 'Do you understand what I have just done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is who I am. And now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet.' And he goes on, 'Because I have set for you an example that you should do as I have done for you.'" Jesus came to have a different ministry, a different kingdom. That's a kingdom of love, grace, mercy, humbleness, meekness. He came to show them this is how we, as followers of Jesus, are to act. Thank you, Jacob. And in fact, later on in the same chapter is one of my absolute favorite verses, in verse 34 and 35, when he says, a new command I give to you, to love one another. He told them about love all throughout his ministry. Now he says, a new command. You are to love one another as I have loved you. By this command, if you do this, then everyone will know that you're my disciple, if you love one another. He keeps saying, as you love one another, that is the main thing that we need to do as followers of Jesus. Well, soon after this, and this is where we kind of speed through some of the other actions that happens, Jesus calls out Judas as his betrayer, and Judas leaves. Then Peter swears he will never leave Jesus, even though Jesus says that everyone will. So Jesus said, you're all going to desert me. And Peter, who is always bold and talk, was right away saying, no, I will never leave you, Jesus. But of course, Jesus says, you're going to leave me. You're going to not deny me three times before the rooster crows tonight. Now we're going to go to Matthew chapter 26, verses 36 through 41. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, sit here while I go over here and pray. So he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. So we know from other gospels that explain this was James and John with Peter. And he goes to pray. Even Jesus, Son of God, needed to pray, needed to have his quiet time all throughout his ministry with the Father. Then he said to the men, he said, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. And going a little further, he fell on his face to the ground and he just prayed. He said, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. He knew what was coming. And see, we if you've seen the movies, if you've seen the shows, the incredible pain, the physical pain that he was going to have to endure is something that we cannot understand. The word excruciating comes from the crucifixion of what he was going to have to endure. But it was actually the mental anguish. It was what he was going to have to do to take upon all of our sins, that he was sinless. But he was taking all that upon himself. He was so troubled because he knew this was coming. But yet not your will, not my will, but yours. Then he tells his disciples. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. He says, couldn't you men keep watch with me for just 1 hour? He asked Peter. I mean, he asked one thing from these guys. Just stay awake with me for a little bit. And as important as this was for them, they were sleepy. I mean, I've pulled all-nighters in college before, but it's usually because of something stupid I did or a test I didn't study for. But this was something Jesus was asking, this one thing for them to do, and they couldn't do it. And he goes, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. And the famous words, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. How many times does this happen to us? We want to do the right thing, but our flesh, our desires, make us want to do something else. I was trying to think this week of something that I've had to really pray for in my life, that I really needed God's help. And I thought, as Jesus was praying for his life and all the people that he knew he was going to have to save through this awful death on the cross, I thought, when my daughter Samantha, which she's ironically here today, when her and Ben were having their last baby, Mila, this was, I think, 1-year-old picture, pretty close to it. I had to pick one of the cutest ones I had, of course. But when they found out they were pregnant, they found out soon after that she was going to have Down syndrome. Now, sadly, you may know this, more than half the people who find out they're going to have a child with Down syndrome or something similar end up aborting those children because they don't want to deal with the lifelong care it's going to take. And of course, that was never a question with them, never. So they have a healthy baby girl, but it was soon after that, like, I came to find out that so many children born this way have to have heart surgeries because of the heart problems they have. And so this little baby was going to have heart surgery, which we don't want anybody. My mom just went through heart surgery, but as an adult, you feel like, okay, you feel a little more secure than a little baby. And so our whole family, we had so many people just praying. Many of you were praying so closely that, God, please take care of this little baby. Please let her be okay. God blessed that. He doesn't always answer our prayers the way we want him to, but he did. And we're so thankful, but here Jesus was praying for his life. Now we're going to go on to the Gospel of Mark. We're going to look at Mark chapter 14, and we're going to look at verses 43 through 52. Now we're going to look at how Jesus was arrested. So just as he was speaking, meaning Jesus, Judas, one of the 12, appeared with him, was a crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests. the teachers of the law, and the elders. These were the people always trying to capture Jesus, catch him. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with him. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard. Meaning Judas, of course. Then it says, going at once to Jesus, Judas said, Rabbi, and he kissed him. I mean, think about if you're in this situation, if you're one of these, if you're in the disciple and think, how can this man that followed Jesus, that saw everything that he was about, betray him? I mean, how can you backstab somebody you were so close with? Somebody so important, but he did. Then the men seized Jesus and arrested him. Then one of those standing near drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Now we know from one of the other gospels that was Peter. Here again, the great thing about these disciples or these gospels is they're all different in the fact that they share a little bit of perspective that the other person didn't share, the other writer didn't share. So we know from somebody else that it was actually Peter did it, who Mark studied under. And then Jesus goes, am I leading a rebellion, said Jesus, that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? You know, every day I was with you, teaching in the temple courts, and you did not arrest me. But the scriptures must be fulfilled. So many of the prophecies that were done so many years ago were fulfilled exactly how God had planned them out. And then he goes, then Mark describes, and then everyone deserted him and fled. So all the disciples who followed Jesus everywhere, just as Jesus had told them at the Last Supper, they fled. They walked away. Except this. And this is one of my favorite parts of Scripture. It says here, a young man wearing nothing but a linen garment. So picture this. A young man wearing nothing but a linen garment was following Jesus. But then they seized him, and when they did, he fled naked, leaving his garment behind. I don't know if you've ever noticed that. Well, the interesting thing is when you read up on the commentary, they'll tell you, this is Mark, who was the young man who fled naked. Mark, who's writing this in the book. Why would you make this up if you feel like this is something that other people are going to read? Now, he probably didn't know that this was going to be the most read book of all time, but read that this was happening. This is one of your most embarrassing moments you're putting on here. Because it's true. It's what people actually saw and it's what they witnessed. So we know the validity of their stories. So after this, Jesus is brought to stand trial before the Sanhedrin, where once they ask him and he says, I am the Son of God, then they were determined to have him killed. Peter then denies Jesus three times before the rooster crows, just as Jesus predicted. And then Jesus is brought to Pilate, the governor, and he's sentenced to death. So next what we're going to do, we're going to go back to Matthew, and we're going to look at chapter 27, verses 24 through 56. But during this, I'm going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to play a song underneath while I'm talking about this scripture. There's a decent amount of scripture here. So there's words that go along with the song. It's got to be at least 15 years old. It's called Thief by Third Day. But it talks about the story of the two men that were on the cross beside Jesus. So that's going to play as I read this. Verse 24, when Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead...
I am a thief. I am a murderer. Walking up this lonely hill, what have I done? No, I don't remember, and no one knows just how I feel. And I know that my time it's coming soon.
They put a staff in his right hand. Then they knelt in front of him and mocked him.
It's been so long, oh, such a long time, since I've lived with peace and rest. And now I am here at my destination. I guess things work for the best. And I know that my time is coming soon. Oh, who is this man?
What happens next? I love how author Bob Goff puts it, where he says, darkness fell, his friends scattered, hope seemed lost, but heaven just started counting to three. So let's lighten the mood a little bit and go into the Easter story, how many of us know it, told first by some kids. Let's watch a short video that
After Jesus died, they put Jesus in a tomb and wrapped him with some white paper. They put a big stone around it and placed guards in front of the tomb to let nobody go in. He was just waiting for the 3 days. He's probably drinking soda while eating hot Cheetos. He would probably play games like Candyland and then have a party by himself.
The Easter Bunny was hiding behind a tree. He probably went out there and just throw eggs everywhere, and then he gonna say, there's one money egg, so you better find it. You gonna get some money.
3 days later, there was a big earthquake.
I think we should go away somewhere safe.
It's like I'm getting out of here.
The earth is shaking. Run for your lives.
And the guards ran off because they got scared.
And then on Sunday, Mary and some of her friends came with some spices. But when they got there, the tomb was empty.
His clothes only was there.
Then an angel came and said,
don't be afraid. Jesus has risen from the dead. Go tell the good news.
Mary and her friends went and told the disciples. She said, Jesus has rising from the dead.
Guys, Jesus has risen from the dead.
And the disciples didn't believe them.
No, that couldn't happen.
Jesus can't raise from the dead.
I don't believe it until I see it.
But all of a sudden, Jesus came, was there.
I am Jesus. I am the Son of the Lord God, and I am Jesus, your friend.
And then the disciples said, Jesus, it's you!
Yay! Jesus is alive!
Totes cool.
Jesus, before he left to heaven, he said,
I have done what I have came to done. Do. And then he risen, then he was going up to heaven. His disciples were crowded around him.
The disciples said, holy guacamole,
I can't believe Jesus really flew.
That's awesome.
Now what?
Let's go tell the news.
It's a fun way to look at it, right? Yes. So now we're going to look at the rest of the story just from a couple of the last Gospels. We're going to look at Luke chapter 24, verse 1. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, and when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. Like he kept telling you over and over again. You weren't listening or you didn't believe him. Then they said, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hand of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11, meaning the other disciples, and to everyone else. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women. I love this. Even after everything that had happened, remember the disciples fled when Jesus was arrested. They weren't around at his crucifixion. It was the women that were there. The guys had all gave up on Jesus as much as they told him this is exactly what would have to happen. They thought that nobody comes back from the dead, do they? This can't happen. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away wondering to himself what had happened. We know from John's gospel that John was with him that had ran there. And lastly, we're going to look back at John chapter 20, starting 19 through 23. Here we go. And it says, on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he had said this, he showed them his hands and his sides. Disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. So finally, they're believing. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you too. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. God's Spirit was among them. If you forgive anyone's sins, then their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Jesus went on to tell them they need to share this message to the masses. This is our role. As Christians, we are to take this news and tell everyone else. God wants everybody to have a chance to be with him in heaven forever and make that choice. They have to choose it. And we as Christians, it's our responsibility. That's why it's called the Great Commission. Jesus told us to go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. All of us here have the cure over death. In fact, I heard a pastor just put it really well for me. I think it was last week I heard this. He said, I was telling somebody just outside, there was probably 5 or 6 people that I've been praying for on my prayer list right now that have cancer or have family with cancer. My dad's one of them. If there was a cure for cancer, but there was just one, there was a pill or an injection, would you complain that there was only one way to cure the cancer? Or would you say, praise God, I've got a cure for cancer. How often do we look at Christianity and say, wait a second, Jesus is the only way to get to God to have eternal life? That's not fair. No, God gave us a way. Praise God, he gave us a way. So that's the trailer for Holy Week, the most amazing story in Christianity. What did it cost? It cost God everything. But you know what? You're worth it. You're worth it. We are all worth it to him. So it's totally up to you whether you believe in Christ or not. That's what true love is by God. I sure hope you choose him if you haven't, because I love you and I want you to have eternal life with him. I want you to have the gift of the Holy Spirit to guide you through your life like I do as well. And I'll end it with this. I've always loved this quote from one of my favorite pastors. It says, anyone who can predict their own crucifixion, their death, and then their resurrection, and then actually pull it off, I'm going to believe whatever that person says. That's why we believe in the Bible. That's why we believe in our Christian faith. Let's pray. God, I thank you for this week that we get to celebrate. What you had to go through by sending your son to sacrifice us for us was something that we can't understand. There's no way we can comprehend. As a father, I couldn't do it. I couldn't sacrifice one child to save everyone else. But you knew that's the only way we could be with you. Praise God, you gave us this way out. Help us celebrate this weekend of what Easter is all about, and then help us do something about it. If we don't know Christ, to those who in this room or watching online, if they haven't given their lives to Christ, you can walk out of this room tonight doing that by praying for that salvation. And if we do, Father, give us the boldness to go out there and share the good news with our friends and family that don't know you. It is in the powerful name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him. Thank you. hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome.
Big round of applause to our praise team. They nailed it. I mean, these powerful songs that are singing hallelujah to our risen Savior. Next week, I want to mention next week, we'd love for you to come back. We're going to talk about walking with wisdom. How do we walk in wisdom as followers of Christ or those trying to investigate Jesus? What does wise discipleship, walking with Jesus, really mean? But I want to share, on the back table, I've got a few of these left, and I can print more if we run out. I've shared this before. This is a little card that I've seen another church has that says, we believe as a church in the Old Testament because Jesus believed in the Old Testament. We believe in Jesus because of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Peter, James, and Paul. These were eyewitnesses to the life and the death of Jesus' resurrection. And over 500 witnesses witnessed Jesus for the short time he was on earth before he rose again to sit at the right hand of God. Put your faith in the resurrected Savior because he is risen. In Jesus' name, amen.